Bishut Torah Rabotai with the permission of Hashem, this Dvar Torah today, it will be for Le'ilui Nishmat, Rachel Bat Moshe, and Abraham Ben Adel Tbel. May Hashem give, and of course, for Le'ilui Nishmat Ari Chaim Ben Simcha Peretz, and Be'et Hashem for the Refuah Shelema for our friend Mordechai Knafo from Morocco. May Hashem will send him Refuah Shelema Melkei Ratzon. My friend, today we will talk about Yitro and Matan Torah. Yitro, he was the father-in-law of Moshe Rabbeinu. Yes, today we'll be going to Baal Shem Tov, not to Shammai, because with the COVID, all the tzaddikim are still closed. So tonight we'll be going to Ukraine, to Baal Shem Tov. So the parasha of this week, the Torah talk about Yitro. You know, Yitro, he was a priest, and Yitro, he become, when he heard all the miracles that Hashem did to the Jews, he decided to come. He heard when the Jews crossed the sea, 12 tunnels. Can you imagine? 12 tunnels for each tribe, Reuben, Shimon, Levi. They were not mixed, each one with his own tunnel. That means that Hashem, he wanted the Jews in Egypt, they were all mixed. The tribe of Reuben, the tribe of Shimon. Now the time has come that all the tribes, they will keep their identity. Tribe of Levi, Levi. Tribe of Shimon, Shimon. Can you imagine those tunnels? They will not accept somebody if he is from Shimon, if from the tribe of Shimon, that this tunnel, it will not accept him to go inside, only to his tunnel. That means it was paralyzed. He couldn't get through. Hey, which tribe you are? Yisachar. Oh, Yisachar is over there. And you, Levi, it's here. And you, Reuben, here. That was a big miracle. That how the Jewish people they started now to build up their own family. Can you imagine what miracle that was? And that's what Yitro heard. Yitro heard that kind of miracle. He said, well, I have to go. So my friend, it's something that you will not believe happened. What happened? That the day that Hashem wanted to give the Torah to the Bnei Israel, you know, there was a big problem. What? Moshe came to receive the Torah. And of course, suddenly he hear Yitro is coming. Now Yitro, he saw nothing. He listened. Usually, when I tell you a story, you listen. If you have Emuna, so you believe. If you don't have Emuna, you will tell me, nah, I don't believe. Now I would like to tell you a story of Emuna. From that story you will understand. It was a big tzaddik. His name was Rabbi Tzhak Minishchiz. Big, big, big tzaddik. They told him there is a kind of bird that this bird he don't sing. But once in his life, when he starts singing, he don't stop till he die. This is saying till he die. And then that rabbi, Rabbi Tzhak Minishchiz, Alav Shalom, he wanted to see that bird. So he went to the zoo, where there is there all kind of birds. And they asked, is there is that kind of bird? He said, yes, there is that kind, but always it's quiet, we don't see. But we know that the mother, the day she started to sing, she died at the end. So he told me, please, I give you an amount of money and do me a favor. When that bird will start to sing, I want to come to see her, how she sing. And I want to see the end of her life. So he said, okay. And one day, Hashem wanted to prove the rabbi, because you know, the tzaddikim, when they pray to Hashem, so HaKadosh Baruch Hu listened to their tefillot. So the rabbi, Hashem, he received the tefillah of this rabbi. So one day, somebody came, knocked at the door of the rabbi. That song, that bird, she started to sing. So the rabbi, he put his coat, he went with his secretary, they went to the zoo, and he saw the bird singing, not stopping, sing. And she was going louder, and then, she felt she died. So the rabbi decided to do the same. He said, what? This bird, she sing till she give her life away? No, I want to do the same for Hashem. I want to sing to Hashem. I want to sing. So he started singing. And then he started praying. And his family told him, stop, you're not a bird. You cannot do that. But at the end, one day, he was praying so close, concentrating his tefillah, and he felt. So they took him to the doctor. The doctor, he said, his heart is very weak. I think he's bleeding inside. And it's a matter of hours. Maybe one day he will pass away. The rabbi, he listened to that. That's it. He listened to that. Baruch Hashem, the rabbi, he didn't die. A few years later, he was receiving people, and there was a big doctor, big professor. He came for a bracha, and the rabbi told him, you're a doctor? He said, yes. Good. You remember me? He said, no, I never saw you before. You remember one day, I was not well, and they came to tell you that I had a problem with my heart, my liver. I was bleeding inside because I was praying so concentrated deeply in the tefillah, and they called you. And you told them, it's a matter of weeks, excuse me, a matter of hours. Remember? He said, yes. Don't tell me it's you. He said, it's me. So the doctor, he fainted. So when they wake him up, he asked them, how you did that? It's impossible. I am a professor. I'm a professor of the lamb. I mean, for me, you were dying. That's it. How are you alive? He said, well, I wanted to match the bird. And he started telling him about the bird. He said, yeah, I heard that kind of bird. When she starts once in her life, before she passed away, she sings till she passed away. Yes, I heard about it. So he said, I said to myself, if a bird can do that, why I cannot do that? If a bird can sing to Hashem, and till she passed away, why we not do that? So when you said, you doctor, it's a matter of days, of hours, I said to myself, Hashem, after all, I wanted just to match the bird. Why you want to take me away from you? I want to see, I want to pray to you all my life the same. Why I have to die? Please. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu sent me Rifua Shelema, and Baruch Hashem. I do the same like the bird. I pray to Hashem till I feel that I'm going to pass away, and then I stop. And Baruch Hashem, I'm here. My friend, that professor, he became very religious. When you see something like that, how we not come? How we not recognize Hashem? A man should think, that's what happened to Yitro. Yitro, he heard all the miracles that Hashem did, so he came to see. He did not have a doubt about what he heard, but he wanted to see, he wanted to live. You know, it's not the same when you hear a story like the one that happened to him, the story, he will tell you the story. It's a big difference. So he came to hear the story of Matan Torah. He wanted to live the experience of Matan Torah. That's why he came. And Hashem, he said to Moshe Rabbeinu, Moshe, go and welcome him. Because that man, he left everything behind him. And he came just for me. So you, Yitro, you came for me. So all the Jews will come outside the camp to welcome you and to give you the kavod that you merit. It's very important that when you go back to Midian, he has something to tell people there. He will do marketing for me. He will tell them who I am. It's not the same what you listen, what you see. Okay, imagine when he came, he saw the Bnei Israel eating the man, food from the Shamayim. He saw the Alani Kavod, how they were protected by Hashem. He saw the mountain of Sinai with the fire. It's very important to see that. Not anyone. No one could come to the camp of where the Jews were in the desert. No one could come. They were protected. That's why Hashem said to Moshe, go, because he cannot come if you don't bring him inside the Jewish camp. And he came for me. Go, welcome him. My friend, you know what Yitro did? He did a big seuda. A big seuda. It's not just a seuda for millions of Jews. I don't know if he had the money. I don't know. Maybe he came with a lot of sheep. I don't know. Maybe he came with money and he bought from the people there. But he made a big seuda. A big seuda. Can you tell me why he did a big seuda? Can you imagine why he did a big seuda? You know who? He invited Moshe, Aharon. He invited all the old people, the young people, everybody. They were welcome to the seuda that Yitro did. But I never understood why Yitro did that kind of seuda. What was the reason? I mean, okay, you came, you saw, you hear, Baruch Hashem, thank you. Do a small seuda, family seuda. A union of seuda between you, your son-in-law Moshe, and your daughter Tzipora, and her children. But he invited everybody. I mean, to do such a big seuda, that means he came with the thought to do a seuda. He came with catering. He came with people who knows how to cook. I mean, it was not a small seuda. It was a huge seuda. It's not I imagine the Gemara said when Yitro did the seuda, we don't talk. The Torah said that everybody was eating with Yitro. So the Gemara asked a question. But what about Moshe? Where Moshe was? Where did he go, Moshe? And the Gemara said Moshe, he was the steward. He was the one who served. I mean, he was the chief of the steward.
you know, there was a lot of people. So Moshe Rabbeinu, I don't understand. Moshe Rabbeinu, he has nothing to do, just to be the chef of the steward to take food. I mean, I cannot imagine. Just imagine Rabbi Chaim Pinto. You invite Rabbi Chaim Pinto, and Rabbi Chaim Pinto, he's a steward. You just imagine Rabbi Shmuel Bar Yochai, a big tzaddik. Just imagine. It's impossible. That's what Moshe absorbed. That means that there is something that we have to understand. Why Yitro? He did this Seuda. You know why, my friend? Yitro, he did the Seuda, and the Torah write about the Seuda. I mean, if the Torah will not write the Torah that somebody did the Seuda for no reason. If the Torah wrote what Yitro did, that means there is a meaning here. My friend, you know what was the meaning? Yitro was so excited. I don't think that he came to do a Seuda. But when he saw what he saw, miracle, he saw the man come in, he saw how the Jews were protected by seven clouds, Shiva'a Anani Kavod, he saw, mamash, things that you cannot believe. He said, I have to do a Seuda, Seuda Todaya. I want to say thank you to Hashem. That I understand. My friend, there's a lot of people, they don't understand. They can see miracles. And they don't care. They can see a lot of miracles. They don't care. Well, maybe they are excited in the beginning, and after they forget about it. That's it. My friend, Yitro, he was not a simple man. He thought he was a big priest. He was a pope. He thought he was somebody. You have no imagination who was Yitro. He was a very rich man. Suddenly he decided that there is something more than me. There is something. What I represent today is not true. The idolatry is not true. He came to the right, to the Emet. For that Emet he did Seuda. It's like Seuda Todaya. Thank you. Usually you do a Brit Mila, you do a Seuda. You do a marriage, you do a Seuda. You do a Bar Mitzvah, there is a Seuda. I mean, there is a Seuda. Seuda Todaya, what it is Seuda Todaya? Seuda Todaya, that means if a miracle happened to you, you do a Seuda. I would like to tell you a small story now. Just a short story that I heard 1 hour ago. 1 hour ago. Last week, I was talking through the Zoom with somebody in Buenos Aires. I cannot tell you the name because it's private. And I asked them, usually I don't call because I don't call. But I don't know what happened. I called them. And then they said, thank you very much that you called me. Now, can you, can we see you with my wife? We talk by Zoom. I said, okay. You call Mr. Marciano, he will connect you with me. That's what they did. So we've been talking. And then I asked them about one of the children. They said, okay, it's Baruch Hashem. So I said, Baruch Hashem, so may Hashem protect them. So suddenly they said, it's unusual. You called us really in the right moment. Because this, our child, we have to do an exam tomorrow. So I said, Be'ezrat Hashem, with the Zechut of Rabbi Chaim Pinto. So I came in the right moment. Baruch Hashem, Be'ezrat Hashem, good news. Baruch Hashem, stop. That was the story. Today, I saw that he didn't call me, but he tried to call me Friday, but I couldn't answer them because it was Shabbat. But in Buenos Aires, it's not Shabbat. Because for us, Shabbat already came. So they called me today. How is it, your son? They said, you cannot believe. The doctor said that we did not expect to see what we saw. We thought it was very dangerous, but your son, he has a big protection from the Shamayim. Hashamayim, from the ciel, from the sky, Hashem protect your son. Because if you came a little bit later, it could be very dangerous. This is Emunah, this is Hashem. Those people did a tzedakah. Those people did a lot of good things. They help a lot of people. They do Bemet Chesed. So Hashem did that. I called them, then they called me, and then they got bracha, and then the Utsdakah Tatsim Mavet, Baruch Hashem. Today, I saw them today, I talked to them. They said, Rabbi, there is only Hashem. Because the doctor said, your son has a big protection from the Shamayim. It's incredible. So of course, Be'ezat Hashem, when their son will come out from the hospital, they will do Be'ezat Hashem a big Seudat Hodaya. Of course, then you will know which family we are talking to. But for the moment, I will not say nothing. Be'ezat Hashem, I know that he will be good, Be'ezat Hashem, with the Hashem. So you see, you do Seuda only for a miracle that happened to you. But I don't understand why he told you the Seuda. You know why he told you the Seuda? He wanted to thank Hashem that he discovered him. You understand? The Torah said he did Zebahim. Zebahim is sacrifice. Because he did sacrifice his Etzahara. You know, my friend, a rich man that he need nothing. And he take time from his time to study Torah, to do mitzvot. This is a sacrifice. He sacrificed his Etzahara. My friend, you know, there is somebody in Paris, in Lyon, last week. He called me. And he told me, Rabbi David, I have to tell you, I don't know how to say thank you to Hashem. I said, why? He said that he told me that he has a COVID, he was very, and his lungs, they were Hashem Yishmor, 70% very ill, he couldn't breathe, so they put him, they had to make him asleep, and they had to put, you know, through his throat, a tree or a tsinor, you know, something, you know, so they can put inside him, you know, oxygen. And he said, before they put me to sleep, I asked my mother, Mama, light candles of Rabbi Chaim Pinto, of the tzaddikim, please do it, Mama. And he told me, he said, Rabbi Levi, I knew that I will live. But then he asked them, please do me a favor. Can you do this operation tomorrow, not today? They told him, no, you cannot. We cannot wait. He said, please do me a favor. I can breathe. Please do me a favor. So he said, okay. Okay, as long as we see that you can breathe, otherwise we have to put morphine on you, we make you sleep, and we have to do what we have to do. And he was praying to Hashem, please Hashem, show them that you can cure me. Please Hashem, show them. Prove. Baruch Hashem, all night or that night, the doctors couldn't understand. His temperature went and the blood pressure started to be not bad, stable. His oxygen started to come. By the morning, the doctors couldn't understand. He was cured.
who is well, he's alive. He's only 22 years old. He's in Lyon, living there. I spoke to him on Thursday. This is Imuna. So for him, he must do as Udat Udaya. As Udat to text Hashem. But Yitro, why did Seudai? He was not between life and death. Yes. There is two kind of being between life and death. When somebody is not well, and when somebody is with the Yetzara. Yetzara, I want to kill him spiritually. And he's fighting. So Yitro was fighting his Yetzara. He was between life and death. To go, not to go. To go to the desert, not to go. To convert myself, not to convert myself. What are we going to do? And at the end, he went. So he did Seudat Hodaya for that. When a man Rabotai do this, you know, my friend, listen to this. Huh? I want to prove to you that I'm right. You know what we do on Kippur? After 24 hours that we fast, after the Neila, we do Arvit. You know what we do? What we said? Now that you did Arvit, Lech b'simcha echol. Now there is a passage in the Torah and the Prophet who said, after Kippur, you can be happy, go and eat. Why? Because Hashem accepted your tefillot. So why there is a passage for it? Why you have to do a seuda? Lech, you have to now go home, eat, be happy, and the dinner that you're going to eat after Kippur, it's a good seuda. Why? You know why? Because we did teshuva. Because we believe that Hashem forgive us. For that, we do a seuda. When you discover Hashem, we don't do a seuda. But I think when you beat the Yitzhara, you have to do a seuda. You know, my friend, when you finish the Siyum Agmara, you have to do a seuda. Why? You do Siyum Ashash, you have to do a seuda. Why? Because when you come to study Torah, the Yitzhara, he don't want you to study Torah. So when you finish the Gemara, wow, you beat the Yitzhara who doesn't want you to study Torah. So you do a seuda. From who we learn this? From Yitro. Hey, yes, my friend. Yes, you know, my friend. Because we're going to go to the Baal Shem Tov later, I would like just to tell you the Baal Shem Tov Alav HaShalom said something incredible. He said there is no Jew that he is Russia. Even that you see a Jew that smoke on Shabbat, don't eat Taref, he's a Jew. He's not a Russia. He is still connected with Hashem. There is an itzut, there is something that connects him to Hashem. There is no, that way, a lot of times we see people who do teshuvah there, we see people that they were far away from Hashem suddenly, if they see something, they do a big teshuvah. This is Rabotai, something that the Baal Shem Tov teaches us, that there is no one who is disconnected from Hashem. There was in Manchester, in England, there was a rabbi who studied in the Kollel, and Baruch Hashem, he has a big family, and his father-in-law, he told him, basta, enough. You have to go to work, teach. I know you have no, you cannot, but teach, be a teacher. At least you will make some money. He said, no, I want to learn. So his father-in-law, his mother-in-law, his father, I mean, oh, then his wife. And then every day he has a baby, a child. And he didn't want, he said, no, I want to study. Hashem, you will help me. But they couldn't fight him. And now he reached, he had
12 children. It's a story, very well story that happened recently in Manchester in England. So all his family told him, it's impossible. We're old people now. We cannot manage to support you. I mean, 12 children, it's impossible. You have to go to work. You at least study half day and teach half day. He didn't want. Surprise. 13 children. 13 children, B'lai Laga. Instead of telling him Mazel Tov, the family, they started to, besides she was a girl. You know, when it's a girl, it's a problem, because a girl costs a lot of money to, when the girl wants to get married, they have to buy her this, especially by the Ashkenazim, by the Hasidim. When you have a girl, if she wants to marry a good Talmid Chacham, the parents of the girl, they have to propose something good, because so that the husband can study. That was terrible. But he told them, Hashem provided the panasa. One day, he received a letter from the judge. He did not know why. He thought maybe it's a mistake. He received another letter. You have to come to the House of Laws. There is a. You must come. If you don't come, you will say, receive a penalty. And no one. They were afraid. Why the judge want to see him? Now it was. So he went. He had to take a lawyer, and he was crying. He said, "The money that I have to pay the lawyer, that the money that I keep for the Brit Mila, now, yeah, right. Are you Mr. X? Yes. You live in the address ta. Yes. You have 12 children." No, I have 13 children. 13. Well, we have a good news for you. Why? There is a man who has no children, no wife, but he left a will. If there is somebody who has 12 children, you give him X money. And if he has 13, you give him all. So they said, for the record we have here in Manchester, you are the only one who has 13 children. So it's your money. So you know what happened, my friend? That man, with the money he got, he bought a house to his father-in-law. He bought a house for his mother, for his family. And now he supports them. I'm doing an inquiry. I'm trying to find out who's that man. From some people that I know in Manchester. I want him to tell me the story, because the story, I read the story here, this page. I want to know who is this man. This man who has bitachon Hashem. So now I ask you a question. Who is the winner? His parent or who he won? He won everything. Can you imagine, there were three people who had 12 children. If he didn't have the number 13, so he had to split the money of the three families. But Baruch Hashem, that his emunah bitachon was stronger, but this man was very tzaddik. He gave a big amount of money to the three families that they did not have children, that they have only 12 children. My friend, now you understand. How much every one of us you should say thank you to Hashem. Not only for everything. Thank you to Hashem for what He gave us. You know, my friend, when we do Aliyah, the Torah, Aliyah Batorah, we say, Asher b'char banu mikol amim, Hashem, thank you that you choose us from, but choose us. Who are you? What's special in you? What are you that you have been chosen? The Torah that you give us. So we thank Hashem. My friend, I would just ask you one question. Today, we do business for the Aliyah. Sometimes people, there is some synagogues in America, there are 1,000 Jews, and they sell the Aliyot. The Aliyah, that means who will read the Torah. On Shabbat, there is only 7 Aliyot. So, among 1,000 people, sometimes there is people that they had to go to the Aliyah because of their bar mitzvah or to see Kaddish. And sometimes it costs. Sometimes it costs $1,000, $10,000, $13,000, maybe $100,000. Maybe that special day there is something special. And they pay. Even today, in most of synagogues, they pay the Aliyah. So I was wondering, why you pay the Aliyah? I mean, it's a privilege to have the kavod. Thank you. To say thank you to Hashem. You know, the bracha. Thank you, Hashem, that you choose me. Thank you, Hashem, that you give me the Torah. And only for that, it costs you $100,000, $10,000, just for that bracha. Yes, my friend. How much we have to say thank you that we have the zichut to receive the Torah and the zichut, the merit that we can do this aliyah and to listen the rabbi reading the Torah. It's a zichut. There is a big tzaddik, his name is Rabbi Chaim Huri, alav shalom. He's from Tunisia. Big tzaddik. There was no Shabbat that he will not buy an Aliyah and some few things. All his money he spent him in Aliyot. And his family, they were fighting him. Why you do that? All the money that you had, you buy Aliyot. He told them, but it's a pleasure. It's a zechut, it's a merit to give honor to the Torah, to value the Torah. It's very important that people will see me as a rabbi, old man, and I spend all my wage, all my money for the Torah, so that they will give the value of the Torah. So the people, for me, you will learn how to give the value of the Torah. Yitro, he was the first one to bless Hashem. He said, Baruch Hashem. He was the first goy, the first person since the creation of the world who said, Baruch Hashem, thank you, Hashem, may your name will be blessed. I mean, can you imagine, the first one to say that? Why Abraham didn't say that? Yitzhak didn't say, Baruch Hashem. Why only Yitro? Well, my friend, Yitro, you know his story. It was not, his story was far away from all this. He was the Pope of idolatry. It was people used to kiss his hand. People used to take blessings from him. Don't forget, he was the friend of Bilam. And Bilam, he was a big Rasha, and the other one, Yitro was a big tzaddik. He came from far away. So what he said, Baruch Hashem, that was, he gives the value of the name of Hashem. That was the Torah was given, the Torah, this parash of Matan Torah. The name of the parash is Yitro. And that's what he did as Seuda to thank Hashem for all what you did, not only for me that I discovered you, but for what you did to your children, the Jews, which whom you're going to give the Torah. Thank you for them. Thank you for me. That, my friend, was it. My friend, I can talk to you a lot. A lot. And just to finish,
this show, then we go to Baal Shem Tov. One day, Rabbi Akiva, he was going in a boat. He was sailing from the boat to travel somewhere. And his students, they were standing and were looking at him till they will not see anymore the boat. But suddenly they saw that the boat was sinking. I don't know what happened. Sinking. So for them, Rabbi Akiva passed away, dying. So they went to the synagogue, to the Beit HaMidrash, they were crying. And they said, oh, la la, Rabbi Akiva, that's it. Big tzaddik died. So they were praying. Maybe there is a chance, maybe he will not die. What about his wife? She will be aguna. What's going to happen? Suddenly, my friends, the Beit HaMidrash was full of people praying to Hashem. And Rabbi Akiva entered the Beit HaMidrash. Just imagine how much they were happy. What happened? How you live? What you did? He said, well, when there was a big storm there, the storm hit the boat started to drown, and they took a piece of wood from the boat, and I hold myself, and every time that I saw a big wave coming toward me, I just put my head down till the big wave come. You know, when there is a storm, you have like a very big wave, like tsunami, and then when she went up my head, I lift my head. And Baruch Hashem, I arrive, and Baruch Hashem, the water pushed me till I arrive here. Rabbi Meir Shapiro, Alav Shalom, the one who established the Daf Ayomi, he said, in this world, there is only problems. We live in a world of problems. We live in a world, there is too much problems. Problem as a tsunami, like a big wave coming, like a tsunami. So what you have to do? Like, put your head down. Pray till the problem goes. Then lift your head up. And daf the word, it's daf. Daf is Torah. Daf Ayumi. You have a problem? The Torah. The Torah will protect you. This corona is the biggest problem of all problems. The variant of the corona. What the corona was last year? It's not today. It's become more dangerous today. Can you imagine? In Israel, in 1 month, we had 1,500 people pass away from the corona. Young people, old people, children. I mean, it was a bad month. Baruch Hashem that today there is with the more or less with the vaccines reduced. But just to tell you, for a country of 8 million people, it's too much. But Baruch Hashem, we see all these problems. It's like a tsunami. So what we do? Put our head down, pray. Pray to Hashem. And then ask Hashem, when everything will be finished, we will do a big seuda. We will do a big hilula. You know how many times there is people who have been going next to somebody who had corona, and they receive a letter. Mister, you have been next to a man, you have to stay home 14 days. How many times we hear that the person that was sitting next to him, he passed away, and he is alive. Baruch Hashem. So he must do a Seudat Hodaya. a big seudah. But my friend, not only for life we have to do seudah to Hodaya. Even when we discover Hashem. Now, every time that I see somebody who did teshuvah, I tell him, do as seudah to Hodaya. Do as seudah. Thanks to Hashem that you discovered him. I did not know. Yes. Why? Well, this is like Yitro. We discovered Hashem at 100%, so we did Seudat Hodaya. Now we have to do Seudat Hodaya, that Baruch Hashem, we believe in Hashem, and Hashem give us tzaddikim to learn from them. Like Hashem said in the parasha of Yitro, Hashem said to Moshe, when the Bnei Israel will see me talking to you, they will believe on you forever. So up to now, Torah tziva lanu, we believe in Hashem, Baruch Hashem. Why? Because without Moshe Rabbeinu, we will not be here, Baruch Hashem. So, it's a Seudat Hodaya. We have to thank Hashem all the time for the Torah that He gave us. So now we're going to go to Baal Shem Tov, Monsieur Vissousson, to pray there, to discover what. My friend, here you are. It's a beautiful place. We've been here, my friend, on Wednesday, and we wanted to be there tonight as well. It's Mr. Israel Gabay who did that film for us. We've been with him for Cesar, Javier, and for Suke, all the people that we used to go to Baal Shem Tov. You remember, we used to come, we used to do all of us this way. We're working with a cigar like the Baal Shem Tov was doing. You know, since the last time we were in Baal Shem Tov, we did not take a cigar. Well, Baruch Hashem, maybe this year with the Corona will be out. It's snowing there. So my friend, look. He is the tzaddikim. Look how much beautiful it is. This is the grandson of Baal Shem Tov. His name is Rabbi Israel, like the name of Baal Shem Tov. He was the head, the man of the Hasidut. His Hasidut started with the Marin Mizrich, his other student, the Baal Tanya, other student, Bitzhak, Rabbi Avraham Malach. And till now, Baruch Hashem, so many rabbis among them, all the tzaddikim that you know. I don't want to mention names of rabbis because there is so many, so we not bless nobody. We not, Hashem Shalom, do not cover to somebody. All the students, the talmidim of Baal Shem Tov, they're here. They're here now. Rabbi Baruch Mizvuj, Alav HaShalom, his grandson, big tzaddik. All the tzaddikim here. And of course, the main tzaddik that we came to, Baal Shem Tov, Alav HaShalom. I have to tell you something, that one day, we were in Baal Shem Tov with Cesar, or the group that traveled with us. We were there, and we spent Shabbos there, Chai Elul. And there was a man there who was with us. So, and we said a lot of Dvar Torah of Baal Shem Tov. And then, to finish the Seuda, all the bread that was left on the table, I give to everyone
to take it with him home. There was one there that he refused. He didn't want. He said, no, thank you. Okay, so somebody else took it. But I was not upset. He don't want. So we came out, and there was a woman that was on Shabbat. She was running toward me, and she told me, Do you remember me? I heard you were here for Shabbat. I said, no, madam. So she said, well, 5 years ago, she had a big machala. The big machala, I don't want to say the name of this kind of illness. And I came for a bracha. And you told me, you are in Baal Shem Tov. What do you need my bracha? You are here in Baal Shem Tov. This is the bracha. But you know what? There is a piece of bread left on the table. Go and take it. And Baal Shem, you will come to Baal Shem Tov every year to tell him thank you. So she told me, Rabbi David, I went inside, I took the piece of bread, and Baruch Hashem, I am well, Baruch Hashem, no problem, Baruch Hashem, every year I come. And Baruch Hashem, I heard, every year I come with the hope that I will see you one day here, and now Baruch Hashem, I see you, just to tell you that piece of bread that we took from the Seuda of Shabbat, and you told me with the Zichut of Baal Shem Tov, Baruch Hashem, I just came to tell you, thank you. I said, again, madam, thank you, not to me, to the Baal Shem Tov. And that man who was there was listening to the story. On one hand, he was thinking, is that story but was made or what? But then he went to that woman, please tell me the story. And she started to tell him the story. So you know what he did? He came to me, he told me, please, I'm sorry. Now, can you give me a piece of bread? I said, go to the room. If you find a piece of bread there, it's yours. And next time you must have Imunat Hachamim. We were born with Imuna. To believe in Hashem and to believe in the Tzadikim. Hashem, we don't see him. But the Tzadikim, we saw them. Today, Baal Shem Tov is not here. But, Baruch Hashem, his Torah is here. His Talmidim, his students, they pass away. But they left other students. Today, Baruch Hashem, you have Lubavitch, you have Gur, you have Tzantz, you have hundreds of Rebbe's, Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem, that they are all. You have Lublin, you have hundreds of rebbeis that they came from the Talmidim of Baal Shem Tov. Baruch Hashem, the Chassidut of Baal Shem Tov, it spread all over. We have our Chassidut in Morocco, our Tzadikim, Nigeria, Tunisia, even by the Litaim, the Gaon Mivilna, Alav Shalom, Rashi, Tosfot, all those tzaddikim, Baruch Hashem. So, Be'ezrat Hashem, I would like to wish to all of you, Barakah, Hatzlacha, Bri'ut, Parnasa Tova, may Hashem protect you, may Kadosh Baruch Hu give you all what you need, Be'ezrat Hashem. So, next year, Be'ezrat Hashem, if Mashiach come, Baruch Haba, otherwise, so don't forget to do, Be'ezrat Hashem. Anyway, you do the Seudat, the Shabbos Seudah, so Seudat Yitro. Because from the Seudat Yitro, we learn a lot of things. And don't forget that last week was the parasha of the man, the parasha of the man, the parasha of the Parhsa. So Be'ezrat Hashem and the Parhsa and the man. And Be'ezrat Hashem, don't forget that with your emunah you can reach everything you want. My friend, here is now the Baal Shem Tov. And I would like you to see, here is the restaurant.
where the story happened a few years ago. It's incredible, incredible. What a beautiful souvenirs. I wish you well. Hashem bless you. Pray. You see the restaurant? That was the restaurant where we were a few years ago when the story happened. From that man that he didn't want to take, and then after suddenly, miraculously, a woman came, and she heard from, and he heard from her then. Because, okay, I don't understand. If he came for, because he has emunah, so he should be the emunah till the end. Not only come, kiss, pray in the cave and go. No. You have to go till the end. You come for him, so emunah. We have a big emunah that's Parhsa Hashem. We see Mashiach coming with other tzaddikim up. Here we have a mikveh. We build a mikveh. On the name of Abraham Pinto. We have few mikveh in Poland, in Ukraine. On the name of Abraham Pinto, may Zichut be with you, Amir Keratzon. Thank you very much. Take care. Bye-bye.